My name is Emmanuel Brunisi. I'm a researcher at EUCenter, a European Center for Training and Research in Earthquake Engineering. It's 9 a.m. on a Sunday, so I really hope you don't mind if I talk for a little about progressive collapse fragility models, in this case for reinforced concrete building structures. I'd like to start with the end, like placing some references in here, just because very many details won't be presented here for the sake of brevity, and also to give credits to people involved in this and to people who contributed to this presentation in terms of material and discussion and ideas shared to put together it. This presentation is outlined as follows: feasibility and needs. We have a big question mark in here. Are there any practical application for fragility models in this case? And the answer is yes. And then the boring stuff, which is essentially the rest of the study, methodology, deterministic case study structure. So I'd like to start with a few examples that are oriented toward deterministic approaches, just to show you structural models and analysis techniques. And then we move on with fragility analysis, so probability-oriented applications. This part is split into two main items, building classes and uncertainty modeling, and then definition of damage states for derivation of fragility functions or models. Finally, some conclusions and further developments. So feasibility and needs. It is well known that structural safety is generally assessed without considering extreme load conditions that, however, might happen during the lifetime of a structure and that might cause global system collapse as a result of a local failure in a single specific portion of the structure. And this local failure will then spread into the rest of the structure, causing this sort of disproportionate collapse. This phenomena is called disproportionate because of the significant disproportion in size between the initial local damage and the final structural configuration. Several definitions have appeared in the literature, and extensive efforts have been made in design and simulation, stressing aspects regarding the assessment of this structural behavior. However, very vast majority of studies are currently focusing on parametric or deterministic aspects, while it is believed that structural safety should be probabilistically assessed and controlled, accounting for uncertainties in loads and system capacity that generally governs the structural behavior for a problem like this. So progressive collapse is probabilistically should be probabilistically assessed by definition. Fragility models are a well-established tool for earthquake engineering application. They provide a graphical representation of seismic vulnerability of structure, and in general, they provide the probability of exceedance of a single or multiple damage states for a given intensity measure. So here is the framework we used for derivation of fragility models. So you essentially need to select your computational models and the methodology for nonlinear damage analysis. Then you need to go with modeling of random properties, random structural properties. We consider materials and geometry and loads for what concern the modeling and propagation of uncertainties. And this was done by assuming a Monte Carlo simulation process, which means that a portfolio of buildings can be generated accordingly. Then you need to go for simulated design of each building prototype, and you need to develop structural models. In this case, we consider two main criteria for the design, meaning that portfolios of structures have been designed by means of UC EC2 and EC8 design procedure, meaning earthquake resistance and static design, static load design only. And we consider just 2D structural models and 3D structural models. Then you need to go for nonlinear damage analysis, which implies that you need to define and identify the most demanding column loss scenario. And you need to also define your intensity measure to undertake analysis and process data. Then you go for performance evaluation, meaning that you need to identify criteria for identification of damage states so as to convolve demand and capacity and obtain fragility data sets, which can then be used to fit continuous fragility models. Just the three key items considered in this study. So deterministic case study structure, meaning that this is an example of a structural prototype we consider for these preliminary studies. Here is a plan view of the building and a table reporting some characteristics of this structure for reproducibility. We have some characteristics of both beams and columns, their size, the size of their cross section, and longitudinal and transverse reinforcement detailing. Other characteristics that I'd like to skip entirely are just reported here for readers and for the sake of completeness. They are four-story, four by four bay systems. You have the design dead and live loads and the PGA, which is the peak ground acceleration considered when earthquake-resistant design is taken as reference. Then characteristics of concrete and steel, the two design criteria considered. So we ended up with EC8 conforming and EC2 conforming structures, modeled by means of 2 and 3D structural prototypes. All models were fiber-based finite element models. In particular, we consider force-based formulation for many different reasons, such as the accuracy of the results. And we consider also two type of analysis, nonlinear static or scroll pushdown approach and incremental dynamic analysis. All simulation have been performed considering the finite element platform seismostruct. It is a video showing the pushdown analysis of one case study structure. In this case, you can see damage, and there is another video that shows you sudden removal of a column, and the structure is subjected to this type of mechanism. The structure oscillates upward and downward and damages and eventually collapse. So just let the video finish. You can see also some characteristics regarding the assumption we made in terms of modeling of structural portions, structural elements, the discretization of masses, and that's it. We can keep on with these images showing the type of deformed shape configuration at ultimate condition for both case study structure. And here you have moment rotation response and axial force versus displacement response of the two structures and key portions of them. This is just to show you that the mechanism, the response mechanism, is driven by flexural and axial hinging mechanisms. You have a difference in terms of rotation demand in different portions of the structure for the same type of structure, and also different type of capacity demand in different portions. There is also a significant difference in terms of catenary action that develops in different structures and different portions of the structure. Then we decided to undertake some incremental mass nonlinear dynamic analysis, meaning that you need to vary the level of downward load applied on the beams. And then you can just compare this type of very consuming, very time consuming analysis versus the Scholl pushdown analysis, which is a single run analysis. There is, of course, some difference, which is due to the fact that the simplified pushdown method do not account for dynamic effects in an explicit manner. Also, there is some dynamic amplification factor versus vertical displacement plot that show you that LA, so linear elastic analysis, are way conservative in terms of dynamic amplification factor. Then another slide that shows you simulation results obtained for 3D prototypes. You have much higher capacity for 3D systems, which is essentially due to the fact that you have secondary beams contributing to the redistribution mechanism of the structure. And you can also see some difference and some effects in terms of seismic design and detailing. In this case, you have much higher much higher capacity and much smaller displacement because of this situation. Then one might argue, okay, what is the accuracy of your structural models? We decided to go and take some experimental data available in the literature, not done by ourselves, to test the accuracy of these models. You can see a comparison between experimental test data obtained by other researchers for a scaled test specimen and our numerical predictions in black. And there is quite a good accuracy. And then also we decided to compare software packages because dynamic test data at that time were not yet available. And you can see a comparison between three different software: Seismostruct, the one we use to derive fragility models, the well-known OpenSeas, and LS Dyna, which is a general purpose finite element software. Again, quite a good accuracy. Then we decided also to consider another modeling approach, which is based on solid elements plus embedded line elements to model reinforcement rebars. And again, we compare this alternative and more sophisticated modeling approach with the previously implemented one. And we obtain, again, accuracy. It is a video showing the type of simulation, in this case, undertaken using LS Dyna. We used some sort of erosion criteria to simulate damage in the structure and in key portion of the structure. It is the damage pattern, the crack pattern in key different positions of the structure, and a detail of damage in the most damaged beam of the studied system. Also, there is a comparison in terms of stress strain response in reinforcement rebars. And again, accuracy is the models are proven accurate. Then some nonlinear time history analysis results. We compare and plot together normalized acceleration, normalized velocity, and normalized displacement time history results. And also we provide you with another plot that shows you the effects of strain rate. Effects in the sense that neglecting them is conservative. You have smaller displacement and strain rate effects in this case can mobilize higher capacity, meaning that neglecting them turn out to be conservative. Then another comparison involving sequencing of different nonlinear material models for steel and concrete. This is just to test the influence that different modeling approaches, or better to say, a different nonlinear constitutive model can imply in terms of accuracy of the analysis. And details can be found in Mussidero et al. Out of it, we can just move on with the fragility analysis, meaning that you need to generate random portfolios of buildings. You have to define different limit states. You can just perform EDA or iterative nonlinear time history analysis to identify the attainment of each limit state for each building of the portfolio. Then you have to assemble a damage probability matrix, and you need to compute the probability of occurrence or exceedance or over exceedance that specific damage state, so as to plot together the probability of failure or the probability of exceeding that damage state and versus the intensity measure QB, and then you have to perform nonlinear regression analysis to fit fragility models. In this case, we consider, as before, two different population of structures, EC8 conforming and EC2 conforming building classes were considered in this study. We again consider two type of structural models, 2D and 3D prototypes were analyzed in order to evaluate and quantify the influence and differences. And then some uncertainties. We consider uncertainty in terms of geometry, materials, and load. Here are the probability distribution functions assumed for every random variable involved in the problem. And then the definition of damage limit states. We consider three different damage states: slight damage, significant damage, and complete damage. And we evaluate them based on strain response parameters and beam drift one. It is a table that shows you the threshold assumed for every single parameter and every single damage limit state. Here are the fragility models obtained for EC2 and EC8 conforming building structures, obtained for 2D structural models. You can see very low scatter, particularly for the significant and complete damage state, and particularly for EC8 compliant building class. Then the same type of results, the same type of fragility models obtained for 3D structural representations. In this case, you can see median and standard deviation for the log normal fragility models derived, as well as the R square, which is the goodness of fit, essentially. And it is a number in between 0 and 1, with 1 meaning perfect fit. And you can see quite low scatter and quite high goodness of fit for all this simulation. Then one might ask, what if? So what if we change the type of analysis? Because EDA is certainly way accurate, but is also computationally demanding. Whilst the pushdown analysis is a single run per frame analysis, meaning that you can also consider dynamic effects in a sort of codified and simplified way. So we decided to repeat the same simulations, considering the same type of uncertainty in terms geometry, materials, and loads. We consider the same type of design criteria and numerical representation. It is another plot showing you what uncertainty mean in terms of material and mechanical properties regarding the stress strain constitutive models for concrete and steel. Then we derive our fragility models again, and we compare those obtained by IDA, IDA against those obtained by the so-called push-down approach. And you can see some sort of difference that is essentially related to the fact that the simplified approach provided by the code for dynamic effects is not so accurate essentially. Here again, with accuracy of our fragility models, even those obtained by pushdown analysis. And also we provide this table where correction factor with respect to EDA models are provided. This is because pushdown analysis is a fast and appealing analysis approach nonetheless. The reason for the mismatch is essentially due to the fact that dynamic amplification factor provided by code is not so accurate, so far at least. And we decided to perform another set of pushdown analysis in order to compute our own dynamic amplification factor for the two portfolios of structure considered, and also for different numerical representation simulated. Just some remarks. Fragility models were optimally fitted to discrete fragility datasets by both IDA and pushdown analysis, particularly for significant and complete damage state. Different fragility levels were associated with multiple damage states depending on binding class and modeling strategy, and also analysis procedure for probabilistic assessment. Significant benefits were obtained from both seismic design rules and secondary beams on the robustness of the system. Clearly, we can do this same approach and this same analysis framework for other reinforced concrete building classes and structural types, considering also the contribution from secondary systems such as infills and slab. Some work is ongoing with the slabs, and some other has been published for what concerns the infills. And finally, I'd like to leave you with a question: what's beyond fragility analysis? Well, so many things in the sense that the same models or the same analysis framework could be implemented within another broader framework for quantitative risk analysis and for loss assessment, for single or multi-hazard applications. Thank you for your attention.